Good morning. Welcome to Spirit of Life. We like to extend a special welcome to visitors and guests and those who are new to our parish family. Please stand as we begin.
Good morning. Please join us in our opening song, Love Knows No End.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We bless you, we adore you, we
Let us pray. O God, by whom we are redeemed and receive adoption, look graciously upon your beloved sons and daughters, that those who believe in Christ may receive true freedom and an everlasting inheritance through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord, you, son of man, I have appointed watchmen for the house of Israel. When you hear me say anything, you shall warn them for me. If I tell the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die, and you do not speak out to dissuade the wicked from his way, the wicked shall die for his guilt. But I will hold you responsible for his death. But if you warn the wicked, trying to turn him from his way, and he refuses to turn from his way, he shall die of guilt. But you shall save yourself. The word of the Lord.
Bow down in worship. Let us kneel.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, owe nothing to anyone except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments: you shall not commit adultery, you shall not kill, you shall not steal, you shall not covet. And whatever other commandment there may be are summed up in this saying, namely, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no evil to the neighbor. Hence, love is the fulfillment of the law. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have won over your brother. If he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, so that every fact may be established on the testimony of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell the church. If he refuses to listen even to the church, then treat him as you would a Gentile or a tax collector. Amen, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, amen, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything for which they are to pray, it shall be granted to them by my heavenly Father. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you,
Lord Jesus Christ. As we celebrate these sacred mysteries on the 23rd Sunday of Ordinary Time, I'd like to begin with kind of a rhetorical question. If we were part of the original followers with the apostles, if John invited us to come and learn something of what he had learned from our Lord, would have we kind of politely said no, because we would prefer to hear it from Peter himself? What if we made decisions or choices of whether we listen to the gospel, the good news, the coming of the kingdom, the call to repentance? What if we had a preference, one of the apostles over the other? The reason I ask that is because when we listen to sacred scripture, and many times, even in this day and age, we almost seem like we're disassociated with what our Lord had left to the apostles. Our entire faith, from teaching to the grace and the sacramental life of the church itself, was instituted by Christ through his apostles. And we see it once again. He talks about ecclesia, church. A couple weekends ago in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 16, we hear of his interaction with Peter, and he refers to it as my church, ecclesia, ek kaleo, in Greek, called out of, called forth, assembly, and that sense of church. We are that church. We are members of the mystical body of Christ. But in that, there is also something that sometimes we don't always make that connection. And that is the successors of the apostles, even the apostles themselves. Why didn't our Lord just write it out and then leave it for everyone to personally take and interpret? We see once again, like in Matthew 16, not only did Peter receive the keys of the kingdom as if like the prime minister, for when he spoke, it was as if Christ spoke first among the apostles. He was also directed, as our Lord said, and this was in Jewish understanding, what you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. What you hold loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Now again, he uses that. Now the rest of the apostles also share, maybe not in the primacy, but they share collectively in that binding and loosening and as part of the church. And so, as St. Ignatius of Antioch, who was martyred in the first part of the second century, some of them who knew Polycarp, who knew John, and the other apostles, St. Ignatius of Antioch, who was either second or third after Peter as the leader of Antioch, as the bishop being led to his martyrdom in Rome, he would offer a lot of insights on what he had received. And one of the things that he would teach, where the bishop is, there is the church. Where the bishop is, there is the church. As a successor to the apostles, he is the one through whom the sacramental life of the church flows. We see that as a successor, this is also directed to our bishop. Again, we go back, why would it seem like there's kind of a structure there, or it seems like power? It's as much blessing and extending the faith as anything else. We know that the different facets of the office of the bishop, one who governs, one who teaches, and one who sanctifies. Even the faculties for us priests and deacons, when we promise obedience to not only the bishop that ordains us, but also to his successors, we realize you can trace that all the way back to the apostles themselves. And it is meant to have that beautiful connection. Again, not an artificial man-made structure, but rather the words of our Lord himself. What you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. What you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. In Judaism, that's not just a juridical kind of a governing thing. It is also in doctrine, interpreting and sharing the truth of the faith and what has been handed down to us from the time of Christ. We realize something. I looked in the catechism, which brings in everything from the councils to scripture, to the saints, to some of the bishops in their role. And in paragraph 1445 of the catechism, it says, the words bind and loose mean whomever you exclude from your communion will be excluded from the communion with God. Whomever you receive anew into your communion, God will welcome back into his. Reconciliation with the church is inseparable from reconciliation with God. As our Lord had said, my church, and giving them the authority of bind and loosening, Again, it's not just a structure, it's not just a governing, but literally a sharing of the faith. Think of throughout history, if a bishop or a pope had to excommunicate someone to deem them publicly that they are outside of communion, it would be not in a way that in an emotional or frustrated or angry way, it would be on behalf of the church that that emperor, as in some cases a Roman emperor who decided he could appoint bishops, he would be acting and in his sin would already be outside the church. Or like a King Henry VIII who declared himself the head and supreme authority of the Church of England, we realize that if it is a declaration, the person who finds themselves outside communion, it is by their own doing. But one of the beautiful things we see, not only in this passage, that binding and loosening, there's that sense that first and foremost, the bishop is the one who can reconcile through that beautiful sense of forgiveness and reconciliation. For the longest time, that Easter vigil was so instrumental in some of those who had publicly offered penance were received back into full communion of the church at the Easter vigil, along with all of those catechumens who had studied and had wanted and desired to be in that communion and receive at the Eucharistic table. So again, as St. Ignatius of Antioch would say, where the bishop is, there is the church. But we realize literally designed and implemented, instituted by Christ himself. Think of how our Lord wanted for us to share in that oneness, and that would be his way for us to realize as a family, there would always be one representing Christ, one who would be the Father to all of us, but also so that it could be handed down personally, this deposit of faith and this sharing in this church, Ecclesia. I'll close with this, because from those words of our Lord to the prophet Ezekiel, that we are called to offer fraternal correction, but in the office of the bishop, almost like the office of the prophets and others, they have that duty to not only share the faith and the very word of God, but Ezekiel, as our Lord had said, he would be culpable for the death of that person if he had not knowingly did not offer that correction to that person. Look at how when it speaks of those, whenever two or more are gathered in his name, it will be granted them in prayer. But also, it's not just fraternal correction, but that every fact may be established in Matthew's Gospel, as it goes on the testimony of two or three witnesses. There is that sense of treating those who are outside of communion like Gentile or tax collector. Think of the councils of the church that had to lock down, this is our faith, this is the doctrine, against like heresies of Arianism or Pelagianism. They would come together as a council. What was the first gathering with the apostles themselves? They had to discern these Gentiles and others coming to the faith. Do they have to follow all of the prescriptions and rules and laws of Judaism? Do they have to be circumcised in order to be Christian? And collectively, as we read in the Acts of the Apostles, they said by the guidance of the Holy Spirit, they do not have to. Where the bishop is, there is the church. But also, my brothers and sisters, each one of us, as part of God's family, yes, we are to offer fraternal correction, and yes, we are to gather in prayer where two or three or more are gathered. But in this context, our Lord is offering direction for his apostles, for they would go out and represent him and establish the central part of the church in the different parts of the world. In every time zone, we share in these sacred mysteries, and we have the same passages from Scripture. We have the same beautiful mystery that we share. And all of that, as our Lord had sent them out, in fact, apostle means one who is sent. Next weekend, we will have an opportunity to offer support for God's share, supporting our diocese, Some of the things that the bishop and the diocese do for us can't be replicated. Some of the things only they can do. Even if I'm to go the faculties to be able to baptize or officiate at a wedding, if I go to another diocese, it goes through the chancery, the bishop, that I am in good standing and that I would be welcome there. Or even the simplest of things, by extension, from our bishop. And so let us prayerfully think of next weekend for God Share, that just as I support my local parish or my parish family, I also support our diocese through God Share. I also support our outreach. In each of those areas, it's as if I am part of that mystery of the church, to the outreach, our brothers and sisters in need, our parish family, for the basic needs of our parish family, but also sometimes we don't fully realize, also our diocese through God Share. May our Lord always help us. May we remain close to Him and realize that as He had instituted these beautiful mysteries, He also instituted us as a family. It's not just a human structure. Literally our Lord's way of inviting us and bringing us together in communion. God bless you always. Amen. Let us stand as God's family together. Let us profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through Him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. God always welcomes us and hears our prayers. Let us pray for the needs of our church and our world.
That the Pope, bishops, and all church leaders will continually seek God's wisdom and guidance. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That world leaders will model the mercy of God in their treatment to their people. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who work, that they may see their labor as a way of becoming like God, the Creator of all things. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we who are called to instruct and admonish one another may never fail to dissuade those who are tempted to abort their children. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the memory of terrorist attacks will renew in us the resolve to work for peace in our world, our communities, our families, and our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who have died and those who grieve them may find comfort in Christ. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may give generously next weekend to the 63rd annual God Share Appeal as faithful stewards of the gifts God has entrusted to us by sharing the benefit of our blessings. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. As we include in our prayers those affected by the hurricane and all those in need, merciful and compassionate God, You give us all we need to come to everlasting happiness. Hear our prayers, that we might be a sign of Your blessings to all we meet. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. For the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church. Amen. O God, who give us the gift of true prayer and of peace, graciously grant that through this offering we may do fitting homage to your divine majesty, and by partaking of the sacred mystery, we may be faithfully united in mind and heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and eternal God, for when your children were scattered afar by sin, through the blood of your Son and the power of the Spirit, you gathered them again to yourself, that a people formed as one by the unity of the Trinity, made the body of Christ and the temple of the Holy Spirit, might to the praise of your manifold wisdom be manifest as the church. And so in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim.
And paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true.
In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless the knowledge and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father. Giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in memory of me.
A mystery of faith.
Proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom of God.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body of Christ keep me safe for eternal life. Thank you.
Join us in our first communion song, Bread of Life. This song is Wonderful, Merciful Savior.
One.
Before our closing prayer, just a few announcements while you're seated. This coming week, with Bishop Kagan, the priest of the diocese will be at the Fall Clergy Conference. And so there won't be masses or confessions this week until Friday. On Friday, things will resume as normal. Also, this coming weekend, September 12th, 13th, as I had mentioned, is our 63rd annual GodShare Appeal for the diocese. Envelopes are in the bulletin and at the front entrances. Please prayerfully consider giving to this. Also, this coming Wednesday night, we will have Exalt, XLT, this Wednesday at 9 from 7 to 8. There won't be confessions, but there will be adoration of the Blessed Sacrament and music provided that draws us closer into that mystery. All are welcome. Again, this Wednesday night from 7 to 8, we'll have Exalt with adoration and music. If there would be an hour of adoration, we were granted just a little bit of extension. For our perpetual adoration, we are required to have two adorers present, not just signed up, but two present. If we're unable to do that, we will probably have to only have those hours that we can have two people. If that's even a difficulty, we may have to just have the chapel available for prayer. Our Lord is still present in the tabernacle, but we need to have committed adorers. If you can invite somebody, if you think you might be able to help us with this, to have perpetual adoration, please contact the office. Let us pray. Grant that your faithful, O Lord, whom you nourish and endow with life, through the food of your word and heavenly sacrament, may so benefit from your beloved Son's great gifts that we may merit an eternal share in his life, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Join us in our closing song, Lead Me, Lord.
Blessed are the sorrowing. these are the bells over here. You want to ring the bells? You want to ring the bells? You want to ring the bells? Over there. You want to ring the bells? Good job. And this is the big book that we read on.
John, what's inside the tabernacle? What's inside here? Do you know who's in there? Do you know who's in there? Who is it?
Is Jesus in there?
Is Jesus in there? Say bye-bye, Jesus. Bye-bye. Give me a hug. Go give me a hug.
Give her a hug, and then let's go.
Okay. Give her a big hug. Big hug. That is a candle.
That is a candle.
Okay, give her a hug, and then let's go.
Thank you.
That's a candle, yeah. Mm-hmm. There's a candle. Okay, should we go? Can you continue with goodbye? Say thank you. Can you return the first time?
Bye-bye. Oh, you're welcome. Have a good day.
Thank you.